Hello everyone, welcome to AI Anytime channel. So I'm starting a new playlist called Fine Tuning of Large Language Models. In this playlist, I will cover, you know, the different aspect of fine tuning a large language model, how to, you know, fine tune on your data set. You will have your custom data sets, you want to fine tune LLMs. In this entire playlist, we'll have multiple videos. We'll start with the fundamentals, and we're starting in this video as well the fundamentals, you know, the different steps of pre-training, fine-tuning, and the novel techniques like LoRA and QLoRA, how to select the right hyperparameters for fine-tuning task, what are the tools that you can use to fine-tune, like XLTOL, for example, that we'll cover in this video, which is a low-code fine-tuning tool, and, you know, how to use LoRA and QLoRA to fine-tune with reduced memory consumption. Now, in this playlist, we'll have videos to fine-tune Llama 2, fine-tune Mistral, fine-tune OpenLlama, and fine-tune other open-source LLMs, and also the closed-source one. Like, for example, you want to fine-tune the GPT models, for example, 3.5, you know, on your data, or the Vertex AI's models, like, you know, that basically fuels the Palm, Google Bard, the Palm 2 models. We'll also fine-tune with those. So this is completely focused on fine-tuning. This entire playlist will have at least 10 to 12 videos. But the first video today, we are going to talk about how to, you know, fine tune an LLM and how to select the tool, the techniques, and the data set, and how to configure and set it up in your infrastructure. For example, how to choose a compute, what kind of cloud providers you can use. So all those nuances we'll cover in this video. So this is a beginner friendly video where I'm assuming that you don't have fine-tuning experience prior to this video. Okay, so let's start our experimentation with this first video where we look at the fundamentals of pre-training, fine-tuning, and the techniques like LoRA and QLoRA. All right, guys. So when we talk about, you know, training LLMs, there are essentially three approaches that we see. And that's what we're going to look at here. So what I'm going to write first is training LLMs. And we'll understand in very brief about these three approaches. So the three approaches that I'm talking. So let me first write the three approaches. So the three approaches that we're going to have is pre-training. And after pre-training, we have fine-tuning. And then we have, on a very high level, there are more, but I'm just writing here which are the commonly used that we have used to fine-tune in the community. So these are three approaches: pre-training, fine-tuning, LoRA, and QLoRA. Now, fine-tuning and LoRAs, and the, you know, even if you go more downstream, I'm keeping this separate because I will explain why I'm keeping fine tuning separate than LoRA QLoRA. Of course, you can use LoRA QLoRA to fine tune. We'll see that. Let's start a bit with definition. We'll go into code. We'll also fine tune shortly. But let's first try to understand, because when I talk to, you know, people who are trying to fine tune, basically they lack the fundamentals or basics of these, you know, natural languages or the terminologies that we see. So I was talking to many of my, you know, colleagues or community friends, and I was asked them, like, what are Q projections, what are projections that you see in the LoRAs that you target modules or whatever. They had no idea about it, and that's what I want to cover here, that your fundamentals and basics should be covered, because the rest of the thing I will show that how easily you can fine tune with tools like XLTOL, and we'll see that in a bit. Now, what do you mean by pre-training? Now, it's pre-training involves several steps. Now, imagine if you have a massive data set of text data. So let me just write it over here. You have massive text data. Now, the source can be, you know, Wikipedia, really Twitter, now X, and you have your own, you know, kind of an your own proprietary data kind of a thing, and these are mainly in terabytes. Okay, we are talking about If you go to Llama 2, they say 2 or 3 trillion. I think it's 2 trillion tokens. We'll come to the tokens later, but just imagine extracting or creating 2 trillion tokens would need at least even more than terabytes of data for you. So in the pre-training step is first is that you need a massive text data, okay, in terabytes. Once you have that, you then identify a model architecture. So let me just write here. Identify the model architecture. And here I am covering, because these topics are really vast, but I'm just covering on the very high level. But even once you have text data, there are a lot of pre-processing steps, like, you know, removing PII, you know, looking at the deduplications kind of a thing, a lot of other things that we look at. But we'll explain that once we are fine-tuning. Okay, but here we're just on very high level to give you a definition of pre-training, fine-tuning, and LoRAs and QLoRAs. Now, once you have a model architecture chosen or created specifically for the task at hand, then you need a tokenizer. Okay, so you need a tokenizer. Let me just write it over here. You need a tokenizer, okay, that is trained to appropriately handle your data, handle the data, ensuring that it can efficiently encode and decode text. So here I'm going to write, the tokenizer will play two roles. One is of encoding and decoding. Not necessarily always encoding and decoding, depends what kind of task you are executing. We'll see that. Now, your tokenizer is done. Then once you have the tokenizer ready, the data set that you have, the massive data set that you created, is then pre-processed using the tokenizer's vocabulary. Okay, so let me just write it over here. Data set is pre-processed. Data set is pre-processed using the tokenizer's vocab. Okay, so you create the vocab or vocabulary of your tokenizers using libraries like sentence piece that goes, you know, that becomes one of the additions in the transformers. I will see that shortly. Now you have dataset is pre-processed using, you know, tokenizer's vocabulary. So let me just write it over here. Tokenizer's vocab. Okay. Now, this is important because this will convert the raw text that you have. You have your raw text into a format that is suitable for training the model. Now here you will have, once you have this, after this step, you will have a suitable, you know, data in a format for training. Right now, and these steps involve, you know, mapping tokens to the corresponding IDs, incorporating necessarily special tokens. So let me just write it, because once I'm explaining the config file or the YAMLs file, once we fine tune, where you have a lot of, you know, special tokens like EOS, BOS, blah blah blah, this is how we'll cover that. So suitable data in a format for training. Now here what we do, now this steps involves, so I will keep it like this. So this steps involve mapping tokens. You would have seen something called map using, when we are using tokenizer to map it. Now mapping tokens, so let me just write mapping tokens to the IDs, to the respective, or I think it's, let's, corresponding might be the right word, corresponding IDs, and then, you know, incorporation of, or rather let's write, incorporating any special tokens, okay, or attention mask can be other thing as well. I just recall, no, attention mask. Okay, now once the data is pre-processed, now it is ready for training. By the way, these are the part of the same. So I will now, these are the part that depends what kind of architecture you have chosen. But now your data is ready. You can pre-train. You are ready to go into the pre-training phase. Now, what happens in the pre-training phase? Okay, let me write it over here. What happens in the pre-training phase. Now, in pre-training phase, let me just write it. The model learns to predict the next word in a sentence. Learns to predict the next word in a sentence. That's what happens. Or not only this, because it can also fill in. So we'll talk about what is fill in and what is generation. Fill in missing words as well. So you can do fill in missing words as well. So let me just write it over here. Correct. This is what it does. Now, this process, of course, involves optimizing the model's parameters, you know, like it's trial and error kind of an experimentation, right? This model, you have to optimize through different parameters, and that's an iterative training procedure. Basically, that maximizes the likelihood of generating the correct word or sequence of word given the context. Now, to accomplish this pre-training phase, we typically employ a variant of this self-supervised learning technique. The model is presented with partially masked input sequences where certain tokens are, of course, we intentionally hide that. And it must predict those missing tokens based on the surrounding context. And because we have a massive amounts of data, right? So we can train it on that. Now, model gradually develops a rich understanding of language patterns, grammar, and the semantic relationship. Now, once we talk about fill in, so you have this fill in missing words that we are talking. That's something that has been called as masked language model. Masked language model, which is called MLM. And when you talk about generation, now that has been called as, or not limited to, by the way, but this has been called causal learning model. That's called causal language modeling, excuse me, not learning, causal language model or modeling. And that's why we use auto causal from, you know, pre-trained or whatever, okay, when you use the transformers pipeline. Now, these are the used ones. We will be focusing on this. This is what we're going to focus, causal language modeling. Now, unlike masked language modeling, where, you know, certain tokens are masked and the model predicts those missing tokens, causal language modeling focuses on predicting the next word in a sentence given the preceding context. Now, this step, whatever you just have seen here on the screen, this step is the pre-training step. Here, your model is now able to understand the language patterns, now understand the semantic relationship and all of those things. Basically, it gets the general language knowledge, making the model a proficient language encoder, right? But it lacks specific knowledge. So after pre-training, right, you have a model. Now it captures general language. So let me just write capture general language. But, you know, it lacks, and this is what we're going to look at the next fine tuning step. It lacks specific knowledge. Lacks specific knowledge about a particular task or domain. And that's why we fine tune, because we want to fine tune it for a specific purpose. Now, to bridge this gap, a subsequent fine tuning phase follows pre-training, right? That's where fine tuning comes in, guys, in the play. Now we'll talk about fine tuning. Right now we are only covering theoretical aspect here. We'll go into code a bit in a bit. Now let's talk about fine tuning. If you want to skip this part, you can also skip this. But I will recommend that you should have the knowledge, otherwise you will not be able to build or fine tune or whatever. You'll be only having very high level knowledge. If you want to achieve that, you don't have to even learn those things. Though there are so many low code, no code fine tuning tools, just upload your data and get a fine tuned model. But if you want to make your career in this field, you should understand everything from scratch, which is required, of course. When I say everything, don't go and read now Marco chain, by the way, that will not help. Now, once we talk about fine tuning, now after the pre-training phase, where the model learns general language knowledge, fine tuning allows, let me write with this. Now fine tuning allows us to specialize the model's capability, specialize the LLM's, I'll write rather, LLM's capabilities and optimize its performance. Okay. Or let me make it more descriptive, on a narrower or a downstream task or a task specific data set or something like that, right? Let me just write task specific data set. Okay, this is what we do. Now, fine tuning, of course, if you look at the pre-training, we have covered all of this high level steps, text data, identifying the model architecture, tokenizer, blah, blah, blah. Now, fine tuning also, similarly, also, it also has many steps. So you have a task specific data set that has been gathered that will probably have labeled examples relevant to the desired task. Now, for example, let's talk about a very famous word nowadays in industry that has been used, called instruct tuning or instruction tuned model. We call about instruction tuned model. Now, for instruction tuned model, a data set of instruction and response pair is gathered. So first thing that you need, a data set here again, a task specific data set. So for this, if you are talking about instruction tuned model, you need a data set of your instruction and response. Data set is gathered. Now, these are basically pairs. It can be a question answer pair. Now, the fine tuning data set size is significantly smaller than the, your pre-training. So you don't need that huge data set now. But of course, even for this case, you need a sufficient data set having, at least 10,000 question answer pairs or something like that. Now, when the pre-training model is initialized with its previously learned parameters, the model is then trained on task-specific data set, optimizing its parameter to minimize a task-specific loss function. Loss function means how off the model was from the desired result. That's basically very layman terms. Now, I'm writing here a task-specific loss function. Now, during the fine-tuning process, the parameters that we will have from the pre-trained models are then adjusted. Okay, you will focus on this word a lot. That's called adjusted, but let me write it over here only. Now, the params, let me just write like this. The params of the pre-trained model are adjusted using, and focus on this word adjusted. We always talk about adjusting weights. Let's adjust the weight and all of those adjustments that we do with the weights. It all boils down to weights, guys, when you talk about fine tuning. Now, using something called gradient based optimization algorithms, not limited to, but this is what has been used in the recent fine-tuned model. that's called gradient-based optimization algorithms. And if you have worked with deep learning, you will probably know about this gradient-based optimization algos. Now, one of these algos can be SGD. Okay, let me just write SGD or ADAM. Whatever, there are a lot more. Okay, now SGD, for example, I hope I spelled it right. Stochastic, and I hope this is right. Stochastic gradient descent. Now, the gradients are computed by backpropagating the law. So again, the backpropagation comes in. Okay, so the gradients are then first computed by backpropagation, the laws through the model's layers. You will have n numbers of layers, allowing the model to learn from its mistakes and update its parameters accordingly. Now, you will have a backpropagation working there for you in this model's layers that helps you. The model will learn from the mistakes every time and then update the parameters so it improves itself. Now, to enhance the fine-tuning, you will have, you know, different additional techniques here. So let me just write it in the one point here more about fine-tuning. Then we move to LoRA and QLoRAs, and then we go up in a bit of fine-tuning kind of a thing. Now, okay, so you can also improve, as I was saying, you can improve through, you know, learning rate scheduling. Okay, there are a lot of other techniques that we can follow. Learning rate scheduling and regularization method. Like dropouts or weight decays or early stopping to prevent overfitting and whatnot, right? Now, these techniques help optimize the model's generalization. Always remember that your fine-tuned model should not memorize but should generalize, okay, on your unseen data or the validation of new data. Now, model's generalization and prevent it from memorizing, as I said, the training data set too closely. Now, this is on the fine-tuning step. Now, we are moving towards some of the newly developed, you know, techniques in the ecosystem. That's called LoRA, low rank adaptation. They have a very good research paper on LoRA. Everybody should read that paper, low rank adaptation. Now, LoRA is interesting. Without LoRA, we would not have seen this, you know, I'll say the rise of the open source LLMs like Mistral or the Jaifa or whatever, you know, the way we fine tune it, because we do not have the resources to do that, right? So for people like, you know, us, the researchers, the developers, the people working in startups, they need these kind of, you know, frameworks to work with. Now, because, see, fine tuning is expensive, as you know, don't be living a dreamland if you are a researcher, or that you will be able to create something like Llama 2 with a limited budget. It's not possible. Even you see how Mistral has been trained, they had invested millions into that. So you can, of course, fine tune a few models on your small data set, but the performance then again will not be similar. So it's fine tuning is, so let me write, FT is expensive. It's simple. It's really expensive. That requires, you know, hundreds of GVs of virtual RAMs, the VRAM. That's where GPU comes in, guys, you know, to train, you know, multi-billion parameters models. To solve this specific problem, LoRA was introduced. Okay, it was proposed. You know, it's compared to fine-tuning OPT OPT 175B with ADAM. That has been the benchmark in the paper also. LoRA can reduce the number of trainable parameters by 10,000 times and the GPU memory requirement by over 3 times. Just imagine it. Now, a 3x memory requirement reduction is still in the realm of unfeasible for us, people like us, because 3x is still not that, right? Then that's, we need QLoRA. We'll talk about that. Okay, so let's talk about. So if LoRA is giving you, for example, and we will cover LoRA in detail. That's why I'm not writing a lot of things over here. Because we have to work with LoRA and QLoRA when we are fine tuning. So we'll focus on that. Now, LoRA, 3x. Okay, I was saying 3x. Now 3x memory requirement. Now imagine. This is also not something that we can work with it. Even we need more. And that's where QLoRA came in picture. Okay, so with QLoRA, and if you don't understand right now about LoRA and QLoRA, don't worry. I will cover that each and everything in detail. Each and every line that we write in LoRA and QLoRA, the code, the configs, whatever the argument that we work with, I will explain each and every line. Now, QLoRA, just add the word quantized. So I'm not writing everything, but quantization, quantized. Quantized low rank adaptation. It uses a library that's called bits and bytes. Okay, so it uses a library called bits and bytes, BNB. This is a library that it uses on the fly, by the way, and it achieves a near lossless quantization. So when I talk about lossless, your performance degradation is not much. Of course, there can be a bit of performance degradation, or there will be a reduction in the performance, but that might be myth. Nobody has done a really a research on big samples that really happens once you quantize the LLM. But of course, there can be a bit of performance degradation, but that's why we are calling it bits and bytes, and that provides you a lossless quantization of language models and applies this to the LoRA procedure, because QLoRA is based on LoRAs, by the way. Now, this results in a massive reductions in memory requirement, enabling the training of models as large as like Llama 270B. Or you can do that on, for example, 2x RTX 3090. You can do that. You can also, and by the way, if you compare, let me just write it up. Okay, let me just do it. If you compare without QLoRA, this will take around 800, which is one of the most used GPU to train LLMs or create LLMs. You need, which is by the way, 800 is 80 GB, 80 GB GPU. Now you need 16x. You need 16 different 800 GPUs, not one GPU node that you need 16. Okay, so just imagine how much it reduce if you use QLoRA. It boils down to 2 RTX 3090, and of course, if you have one 800, much better. Okay, to do that, but just imagine, and the cost goes down once you use LoRA and QLoRA. Okay, now let's see. The question comes in that, okay, we have been talking about all of this thing. How can we achieve our task? How can we, fine tune? What kind of machine we have to use? And all of the questions that you will have in your mind. So for that, I will tell you that let's go into fine tuning. So let me just write over here. Fine tuning. We are now going into fine tuning step. In this tutorial that I'm creating, we'll be focusing off, 6B or 7B LLMs, not more than that, because I want to keep it as a tutorial. You can explore yourself if you have compute and all. I do have compute, but you should learn and you should, of course, do it yourself, right? Now, the first thing that you think will come in your mind is training compute. That tell me about training compute. And that's what I also, get worried. Okay, training compute. Now for training, of course, you need a GPU to do that. We'll talk about model and data set separately. That's something that we'll have something. Now, if you want to fine-tune a model like Llama 2.7b or Mistral 7b, let me just write it over here. Now, these are the model I'm writing, because these models are commercially available to use in an enterprise. You can make money, using these models, guys, because you will be building a product. So don't see that just you'll be making money by using this model, but once you build a product on top of this. Now Llama 2.7b and Mistral 7b, if you want to fine tune on a very high level, I'll say these are the requirements that you need. I'll first talk about memory, and this is based on Eleuther AI Transformers Math 101 blog post. I will give the link in description. If you want to understand how calculations work, to decide a compute, you should look at Transformer Math 101 blog post. Find the link in description. Now, the memory requirement is around, let's keep it like 150 to 195 GB. This would be the memory requirement, to fine tune. Okay, now, so renting GPUs. Now, the next thing is how to rent GPUs or how to use a GPU. There are many options that you can consider. One is the most, it's not in any order, but I will write in my preferred choice. Okay, in an order. I rely on RunPod, runpod.io. I rely on RunPod. Then there is Vast AI. Then there is Lambda Labs. And then you have hyperscalers, like big players. You know, I will just only write AWS SageMaker because I have worked with it a lot. So these are the top, and you have your Google Colab also. How can I forget Colab, our lifesaver, right? Now, RunPod is my preferred choice. Hands down, RunPod is my preferred choice. I will recommend you to choose RunPod or between Lambda Labs, but Lambda Labs service support and all are very bad. Okay, so RunPod is something that I recommend. It's extremely easy to work with and also affordable. If you're looking for cheapest option that you can afford, which is Vast AI. So let me call it here. Cheapest. I'm writing cheapest. I'm not writing affordable. Affordable is like RunPod. Now here, security can be a concern. So look at if you are looking at secure cloud or a community cloud kind of a thing. I recommend RunPod. That's what I said. Okay. Now, if you have a supercomputer, you can also do with that. But I do not have. Now, the next thing is once you have training compute decided, once you have a training compute, then you have to gather data set. I will show you that how you can get a data set if you do not have one. The main source for learning purpose is Hugging Face data sets. Once you have the data set, and I'll cover a few things in data set because, once if you have you are creating your own data set, you have to look at something called these few things you have to look at. One is diversity in data. You do not want your models to only do one very specific task. You should have a bit of diversity. Now, assumed a use case like, you're training a chat model. That does not mean the data would only be about one specific type of chat, right? You will want to diversify the chat examples, the samples, like different scenarios. So model can learn how to generate outputs of various type of input. Now imagine one of your end user comes in and start putting about some question that your model have not even seen, so at least those kind of things. So it understands the semantics better. Now the size of data set. On a very like a thumb rule, your file size should be 10 MB. That's how I decide. If you are using a CSV with question answer pairs, your file size should be 10 MB. That's how I go with 10 MB of your data. Okay, now, or at least I'll recommend 10,000 question answer pair. And the quality of data. This is important because if you look at the latest model, and this is the most important, by the way, this is the most important thing. Phi is example, Phi LLM by Microsoft or Orca, for example. These are the examples where organizations have shown that how a better quality data can help you, train an LLM on a very smaller size, like 3B or 1.5B kind of a parameter of params. This is important to understand. Now, we'll not talk about data at this moment. Let's see that. So to use RunPod, what we have to do is to go to RunPod dashboard here, and you can see I already have a template has been deployed, but it's very easy to do that. You have to come to secure cloud. You can also look for community cloud, but I prefer this. The community cloud is a bit cheaper because your GPU can be also, availability is an issue on community cloud because the same GPU can be rented by somebody else's as well if you are not using that. Now, that's on the community cloud. On secure cloud, they have two things, latest generation and previous generation. On latest generation, you will see the latest of GPUs like H100, which gives you 80 GB VRAM with 250 GB RAM, which is the most expensive one over here. Then you also have previous generation with A100, and that's what we're going to use. Okay, so A100, you can see almost $2 per hour. So 1 hour training, you cost $2. So on, for example, if you have decent enough data set like 2000, 3000 rows, $5, you'll be able to do it. Now, for that, let me first show you a couple of things. We have eight maximum that you can, spin up over here, the eight different node of that particular A100 GPU. But this is not what we're going to do. Okay. So let's see how we can deploy it, how we can fine tune it. So I already have deployed. What you have to do, you have to click on deploy and it will deploy. It will take a few minutes to deploy it. And then there will be option to connect. Once you click on connect, it will show open JupyterLab. And that's what I did over here. I have a JupyterLab. Now, the first thing that we have to do is we have to git clone the xltol. So let's git clone. So git clone, and then we'll take that from here. So come over here. Let me just click on this, and then you clone. You'll see a folder here. Now let's go inside the folder. In the examples, you will see different models which are supported. You can also see the Mixtral are also supported very soon in this. Okay, if you click on Mixtral, you will see Mixtral YAML. So Mixtral is also there. 8x7b model by Mixtral, the mixture of experts. Now, if you go back to examples, you will see Code Llama, Llama 2, Mamba, Mixtral, MPTs, Pythia, Red Pajama, and some of the other LLMs are also there. Let's open, for example, Open Llama. So if you open Llama, you will see config.yaml. Now in config.yaml, you will see all these details. I will explain each and everything, in a bit. What do you mean by load in 8-bit, load in 4-bit? What is LoRA R, which is not there because that will be in your QLoRA or LoRA. If you click on LoRA YAML, this is a configuration file which helps you, xltol basically takes this single file as an input and fine tune your model. Here you have to define your data set. If you look at the data set, it says GPT-4 LLM clean. There is nothing, but this is available on your Hugging Face repository. So it basically takes the data from there, but you can also do it from locally as well. So if you have local machine where you are running this and you have your data locally, you can also assign the path from that local machine as well. It has your validation, adapter, blah, blah, blah. And we'll explain that everything in a bit. What do we mean by QLoRA, where bits and byte things will come in picture? You can see load in 4-bit will be true for QLoRA because you're going to load this model in 4-bit and something like that, right? Let's do that. So what I'm going to do is, first thing, let me go back to my folder here, and you will have a requirements.txt. Let's expand that. Now you have your requirements.txt. Now in requirement.txt, we'll find out everything. Okay, what are the requirements thing that, you have extra in CUDA you are getting from here, and a lot of other things that you are getting. Now, I will make some hashes. We don't need this, or rather what we can do, we can just remove this from here. We do not need this anymore because we already have CUDA with us over here. Now, CUDA is not required. Any other CUDAs that you see, I do not see any other CUDAs over here. I'm just looking for Torch, AutoGPT packaging, PEP transformers, tokenizers, bits and bytes, accelerate, deep speed, addict, fire, PyYAML, datasets, flash attention, you can see 2.3.3, sentence piece, vendor B, weights and biases, EI NOPS, XFormers, Optimum, HF transformers, Kulrama, Numba, BERT score for evaluation, evaluate, Rouge score for evaluation as well. We have scikit-learn, ART, FSChat, Gradio, TensorFlow. Fine. Let's save this here. Okay. Now, once you save it, I'll just close this now. Let's go CD inside it. CD. So let's do CD. So CD xltol. And you can see AXAO, I am always, typing it wrong, but I'll just CD inside it. And let's do a PWD to find out what is my present working directory. You can see it xltol. Now the next thing that we have to do is, okay, we have to look at the installing the packages. Let's do what they suggest. I'm going to do pip install packaging. So pip install packaging is a requirement already satisfied. The next thing is pip install and then hyphen e, which basically says okay within this directory, or you can also take it from their I'm saying, okay, flash attention and deep speed. So let me just do not need that. Okay, deep speed. Okay, flash attention and deep speed. Let's run this. What are the thing that I am making a mistake? Deep speed, flash attention. It should not be dot here. Like, my bad. It should be dot, should be the outside of here. Okay, you have your flash attention and deep speed thing going on. Okay, over there it will install everything which is in your requirements txt. You can see a bird score, numba, sentence piece, which is dependency of transformer, helps with, you know, vocabulary addition, tokenizer, blah blah blah. Now PEFT has been installed, bits and bytes, accelerate, that's looking good. Let's see it out over there. Come down to flash attention. Make sure you have flash attention greater than 2.0. Flash attention 1 point will give you error. Okay, let's come down to it's installing it. Once you install that, you can also go to the dataset path. If you don't want to use this data, you can also do that with other data as well, but I will keep the same data. But we can make few changes if you want. Let's, you know, because we are relying on LoRA here, we'll use LoRA. So if you come to LoRA, okay, let me come to LoRA, low rank adaptation. Now once you come to LoRA, you can do a bit of changes, like, you know, let me see what is the epoch. Okay, where is that number of epochs? This is too much. I don't want four epoch. Okay, let's do it for one epoch. Okay, so for, we'll do it for one epoch. Okay, the number of epochs become your number epochs become one. Micro batch size, I'll also make it one. And gradient accumulation steps, I'll make this 8. Okay, I will explain that. Don't worry if you don't understand these terms. We'll explain each and every these terminologies which has been written over here. Now I made some changes, and then I'll go back and then I will execute my learnings. Okay, that's what I'm gonna do. Okay, now let me just do a save. Okay, and if you come, you can also see it over here. This is how you can train it out. You can see it says uses. This is how you can train. This is how you can inference. All right, so execution of learning will happen like that. So let's come to fine tuning here. Now we are done, we'll add few cells. And once you have done all of these changes, let's go back and maybe you can copy this thing quickly. Let's copy this. Let me come over here. Yeah, and I have to add that. You can see accelerate, launch, hyphen M, xltol CLI, train, examples. It has open llama. Now, for example, if currently you see it says open llama, now you have to go to open llama 3b. I don't know which one I changed up. Okay, if you go to LoRA, yeah, this is what I also changed. Okay, fine. Now let me just close this one, LoRA YAML, and let's run it. Now once you run it, you will see a few warnings. You can ignore those warnings, or you don't have to worry about those warnings. You can see it's currently downloading the data from Hugging Face. It will, you know, create a train and validation splits. You can see it's currently doing. It will also map the with the tokenizers. It will also do that. You can see it's happening over here. You have to wait for all this process. Basically what they do, guys, right, it's, imagine this as a low code fine tuning tool. If you don't want to write a lot of code, you just want to make some changes, because they already have created the YAML for you. Okay, this is what they have done. You can see total number of steps, total number of tokens over here. Find out the total number of tokens. Currently getting the model file, which is PyTorch model.bin, the file that it's getting. You can see it's around 6.85 GB. You know, RunPod is basically will have some cache, of course. Definitely they will have some cache and container cached in the container, because, you know, you are just fetching it from Hugging Face directly. That's why it's a bit faster. If you do it, of course, locally, it will probably be not that faster. Okay, It will take a bit of time. Let's see how much time it takes. I don't want to pause the video because I want to show you each and everything that goes. If you want to, you can skip the video, of course. You can see, you know, extra special tokens, EOS, BOS, padding, total number of tokens, supervised tokens, all those details over here which have been listed. Okay, that we can find it out. Once the model has been downloaded, which is your PyTorch model.bin, the next thing that we have to do, it will also load the model. Okay, so basically once it loads the model, once it loads the model, your CUDA kernels should be there, because once it's loading, it needs GPU to load that, okay, on a device. Okay, that's when we do .2 device or something to, you know, pipe that with CUDA. You can see it says starting trainer, so it has a trainer argument. I will explain that. Don't worry if you do not know about trainers and all. We'll explain each and everything in detail. Now, guys, what will happen? You see, it has started training. Okay, you can see efficiency estimate, total number of tokens per device. It's training your on your data. Now, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna pause the video till it's train or fine tunes it, and then we'll look after that. All right. So you can see it has been fine tuned. The model that we wanted to fine tune, we have fine tuned the LLM, and you can find out train samples per second, train runtime, train steps per second, train loss epoch. It has been completed 100%. It took more than 1 hour. It took around 2 hours. You know, it took 1 hour 55 minutes. You can see it over here. Let's go back here in the workspace, exit all, and you can find out here you have a folder called LoRA out. Now in LoRA out, you have your last checkpoint, and you can keep on saving checkpoints. We'll cover that maybe in the upcoming videos, where we will have a lot of videos on fine tuning now. But what I'm trying to say is that you can also save it on multiple checkpoints. For example, if you want to use 1,000 checkpoints with it, you can also do that. But you can see here we have our adapter model.bin and adapter config. Right now, you can also merge that with PEFT, but I'm not covering that part right now here, because you would have no idea about PEFT if you are a beginner. So now you just saw that how we fine tuned a model and we got our checkpoint weights over here. You can find out this is the last checkpoint if you want to use this, which has a config JSON, which has, if you click on the config JSON, it will open a JSON file for you. Then you have your, you know, safe tensors, okay, the model weights. Then you have optimizer.pytorch.pt. Then you have your scheduler, you have your train state. You can find out all the related information over here. You can also close this. Target module, 7 items. You can find out all the different projections. I will cover each and everything in detail. What do we mean by this? Now, it shows that sometimes it gives you error. If you look at this gradio, if you run this gradio, sometimes in RunPod it gives you an error also, because let's try it out our luck here. I just want to show you that you can also do that. Yeah, gradio installation has issues within RunPod sometimes when you are using it. But anyway, we'll move. If it works, it will open a Gradio for you, a Gradio app. Gradio is a Python library that helps you build, you know, web apps. Okay, you can see it says running on local over here. Okay, now it runs on a local URL. Okay, you have to probably do a true, share equals to true something to, you know, get it on a URL. Okay, now you can also click on, let's click on this. Now, once you click on this, it says this share link expires in 72 hours. For free permanent hosting and GPU upgrades, run Gradio deploy. Okay. Now you can see that we have an Axeltal Gradio interface. Okay. Now here you can try it out. Now if you, let's copy this and see what kind of response, or even if it's generating any response or not. So if you click on this, it will either give you an error, or it says, okay, you can see give 3 tips for staying healthy. And you can see it out over here. Eat a healthy diet, consume plenty of fruits, vegetables, whole grains, lean proteins, blah, blah, blah. And you can see the speed as well, because we are on 800 right now, that you know. And it's generating your responses pretty fast, right? Look at the tokens per second over here. Now you have an interface that is working on your data. your data that you have from Hugging Face. For example, we have used alpaca here, alpaca 2k test. You can see it's how it says, how can we reduce air pollution? Let me ask a similar question, but not exactly the same. So what I'm going to ask here is, tell me the ways I can reduce pollution. Let me ask this question. Now I'm asking, tell me the ways I can reduce pollution. It says, make a console. And when you are working with Python, you have to use a prompt to look at the, basically to parse the output a bit, but this is fantastic, right? Now you can see it says, make a conscious effort to walk, bike, or carpool to work, school, or errands rather than relying on a single occupancy vehicle. Use public transportation, carpooling, blah, blah, blah. Reduce, reuse, and recycle. We're talking about a bit of sustainability over here. Now, this is fantastic. You saw in 2 hours, at least for one epoch, of course, that is fully customizable as we saw in the over there in the YAML files. But this is how easy it is nowadays to fine tune, guys. We'll now talk about, we'll go back to our cast here and we'll talk about each and everything in detail. Okay, now how did we fine tune? What are the PEFT configs that we have considered and all of those things? So let's start our journey with all these parameters now. Let's understand how LoRA works and what is LoRA and how these parameters are being decided that we have seen in the YAML file as well. So let me just write about LoRA here. So we're going to talk about LoRA now. Now it's a training method. Let's see this as a training method. Let's keep it lemon so you can understand better. It's a training method. So I'm writing it's a training method. To expedite the training process of LLMs. Training process of LLMs. This helps you with, of course, memory consumption. It reduces the memory consumption by introducing something called pairs of rank decomposition weight matrices. This is important. So what I'm going to write here is, look at this word here. Okay, something called rank decomposition and basically that's a pairs. So I'm going to write pairs of rank decomposition matrices. And this basically also known as, right, we have a, as we also talked about this earlier, called update matrices. Okay. And you will have some existing weights already of the pre-trained LLMs that we're going to use. So basically, you know, it helps you, you know, add these weights. Okay. Training this, basically the new added weights. Okay. Now, there are three things that you should consider when we're talking about LoRA. The first is the, or I'll say three or four, let's understand that. Okay. Preservation of pre-trained weights. So let me just write it over here. So preservation of pre-trained weights. That's the first thing. Now, what we understand by this, like LoRA basically maintains the frozen state of previously trained weights that basically minimize the risk of catastrophic forgetting. Now, this particular step ensures that the model retains its existing knowledge. So let me just write it over here. Okay. Model retains its existing knowledge while adapting to existing knowledge while adapting to the new data. That's why we call it, right, that LLM still has the base knowledge, and that's why sometimes it hallucinates, gives it from the base knowledge, right, while adapting to new data. Now, the second thing which is important for you to understand, the portability of trained weights. Can you port that? Okay, so let me just write it over here. Portability of trained weights. The rank decomposition matrices that gets used in LoRA have significantly fewer parameters, of course, right? That's why it helps you with the memory reduction, right? When you compare this with original model. Now, this particular characteristic allows the trained LoRA weights to be easily transferred and utilized in other contexts, making them highly portable. So it's highly portable. Now, the third thing is, the third advantage that we're going to talk about is integration with attention layers. Integration with attention layer. Now, LoRA matrices are, you know, incorporated basically into the attention layers of the original model. The adaptation scale parameters that we'll see that parameter once we are looking at the code allows control over the extent to which model adjusts to the new training data. And that's where we'll see about, you know, alpha or the scale that has been used. Now, the next one is memory efficiency. That's the advantage that we also talk about is memory efficiency. Now, it's improved memory efficiency, as we know, opens up, you know, the possibility of running fine-tuned tasks on less than, as we discussed earlier, 3x the required compute for a native fine-tuning process without LoRA. Let's look at the LoRA hyperparameter. Let's look at the code now to understand the LoRA hyperparameter. So go to examples of the same Exaltol GitHub repository. Let's open any. We trained basically open Llama, right? Fine-tuned. Now you can also open Mistral also. Let's open. Or let me open Mistral now to show you. So you can see I am opening Mistral, and the Mistral, let's go to QLoRA. Now on the QLoRA, I will first talk about the LoRA config. Let me make it bigger so you can see it. And let's talk about this. These are your LoRA hyperparameters that we're going to talk about. And I will explain that what we mean by this. You fine tune any LLMs, you go to any videos, any blog, you will see this code. Now you should have. You should have the understanding, you should know that what are these means. Okay, so let me just show it over here that what are these things mean. Now on the memory efficiency, the next thing that we're going to talk about is LoRA hyperparameters. So I'm just writing LoRA hyperparameters. Now, the first thing, if you go back, you have something called LoRA R, which is nothing but the LoRA rank. Okay, so let me just write first thing. You should know what is LoRA rank. Okay, so let me just write it like that. Okay, that's called basically your LoRA rank. Low rank adaptation rank. What do we mean by LoRA rank, guys? This basically determines the number of rank decomposition matrices. Now, rank decomposition is applied to weight matrices in order to reduce memory consumption and computational requirements. If you look at the original LoRA paper, recommends a rank of R equals to weight 8. Okay, so by standard, let me just write here, you know, by the paper they recommend standard R equal to 8, but here you can see for Mistral, you know, in Axaltol GitHub repository for Mistral is it's has been written 32, and 8 is the minimum amount. Keep in mind that higher rank, if you have higher rank, leads to better results. Better results. And there is one trade-off now, but for that you need high compute. So now you should know that if you are getting any errors, like, okay, you have, you know, it's taking a lot of computational power, you can play around this hyperparameter, which is LoRA rank. Make it 8 from 32, make it 16 or something like that. You know, it's a trial and error experimentation. Now, the more complex your data set, your rank should be higher. If you have a very complex data set where you have a lot of relationship, a lot of derived relations, and so on and so forth, you need your rank to be on the higher side. Okay? Now, to match a full fine tune, you can set the rank to equal to the model's hidden size. This is, however, of course, not recommended because it's a massive waste of resources. Now, how can you find out the model's hidden size? But of course, you have to go through the config JSON, by the way. Okay, or so there are two ways of reading or basically finding out. So let's say reading hidden size. Now, there are two ways. One is config JSON and the other is that you can do it through transformers auto model. Transformers auto model. I think I can quickly, you know, write the code here. So let me just write the code for you. Now this is how you have your auto model. So from transformer, let's quickly get it. So for example, from transformers, import, you have auto model. As we do it, we do auto model for causal. So you have your causal LM. That's how you import. You define a model name, then you will have an identifier. So let's define that model name, whatever. Then you have your, that you basically get your model now through auto model, something like that. Now, how do you find the hidden size? This is the code to get the hidden size. You do it something called model.config dot hidden state. That's how you do it, hidden size. And then just print the hidden size. This is how you do it. Print the hidden size, right? Let me open here llama 2. Let's go to, you know, any of this. Okay, it's fine. You can see it over here. Hidden size is here, 8192. Right? This is your hidden size. You can find it like here also, and you can also find it, you know, through transformers library JSON. But this is not recommended because it's a waste of resource. Otherwise, why would you use LoRA then? But this is what it is, right? If you want to really achieve those performances of pre-training, like how Meta has created Llama 2 or Mistral AI has created Mistral. The next is, let's go back. Next is LoRA Alpha. Okay, so let's write it alpha here. This is a scaling factor. Now I'm writing LoRA alpha. Now it's the scaling factor for the LoRA determines the extent to which the model is adapted towards new training data. The alpha value adjusts the contribution of the update matrices during the training process or during the train process. Lower value gives more weight to the original data. So if you have lower value, it gives more weight to the original. And it maintains the model's existing knowledge to a greater extent. So it will be more inclined towards the, you know, your base knowledge, the base data that you have. So let me just write it. So for example, you will be able to make a note of it. I will write lower value gives more weight to the original data. To the original data and maintain the model's existing knowledge to a greater extent. Let's try it like this. Okay, this is what. Now if you can see here, it says LoRA alpha. And that LoRA alpha is 16. You can make 8 also. You can make 16 also. So it depends. Now the next is, let's talk about LoRA target modules, which is again very important. You know, talking about the LoRA target modules that you see over there. Now, LoRA target modules is one of the important things. So let me just write LoRA target module. Oh, you cannot see it. I just noticed. LoRA target module. Now in the LoRA target module, here you can determine which specific weights and matrices are to be trained. The most basic ones to train are the query vectors. That's basically called Q projection. Okay, you would have seen that word Q projection. So the most basic ones are the query vectors and value vectors. So let me just write it over here. You know, query vectors. And then you have value vectors. That's called Q projection, Q proj, and this called V proj. These are all projection matrices. The names of these matrices will differ from model to model, of course. You know, it depends on which LLM you are using. You can find out the exact names. But again, there is a What you have to do, keep the same code as written above, just make one changes, which is your layer names. So layer names, we, you know, basically it's a dictionary, and that's how you'll get it. Let me show it, write it over here. Model.stateDict and then dot keys. This is how you will get the, and basically you need a for loop now because there will be n number of layers. Okay, so you can get the for name in layer names and then you can print that. So you will see Q projection, you know, you will see K projection, you will see V projection, you will see O projection, you will see gate projection, you will see down projection, you will see up projection, layer norm weight, blah, 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 right? So there can be n number of weights. Now the naming convention is very easy, model name dot layer, layer number, component, and then it goes like that. So this is what you should note, the Q projection, the projection matrix applied to the query vectors in your attention mechanism of the transformer blocks transforms the input hidden states to the desired dimensions for effective query representation. And V projection is a bit different, it's called a value vectors in the attention mechanism, transforms the input hidden states to the desired dimension for effective value representation. So these two are very important, QProj and VProj. There are others like that, like KProj, which is key vectors. Then you have OProj, which is different. So you can keep on looking at, you know, different, basically OProj are nothing but the output to the attention mechanism. So, you know, so however, three or four, you know, there are outliers as well. We have to look at outliers. They don't follow the naming convention specified here that when writing, but they have embedding token weights, embed tokens, normalization weights, normalize, and you have LM heads. These are also, if you go back, by the way, excuse me, sorry. Then you have your, you know, LM, which is not, of course, here because this might not be using it, but you have LM head. Let me just write it out over here. You have LM head. So you have LM head. Then you have embed tokens. Then you have embed tokens, then you have normalization, norm. These are also that we consider when we are training it. Now, the LM head is nothing but the output layer of a language model. Language modeling, I'll say rather. It's responsible for generating predictions or scores for the next token based on the learned representation from the preceding layers, the previous one. You know, basically they are placed in the bottom. So important to target if your data set has custom syntax. LM head is very important. Let me just write it over here. If your data has custom syntax, which is, you know, really complex. Embed tokens, they represent the parameters associated with the embedding layers of the model. It's like very self-explanatory, usually placed at the beginning of the model, as it just has to map input tokens to their vector representation. You have your input tokens, you have to first convert it to a vector, then the model will be able to understand, right? It needs a numerical representation. It cannot understand your text data. It's important to target, again, if you have your custom syntax. So this goes same. Now, normalization is very, like, no, very, I'll say, common. It's a normalization layer within your model used to improve the stability and convergence. So basically helps you with the convergence of, you know, deep neural networks. But this is what we look at the LoRA guys. Then we look at the QLoRA. Now in QLoRA, we talk about few things. We'll talk about, if you go back here, let me just explain. QLoRA bits and bytes will be on somewhere here. So basically, I'll just explain. So quantized LoRA is an efficient fine-tuning approach. You know, even makes it more memory reduction. So it includes few things. The number one is back propagation. So let me just write over here. Back propagation of gradients through a 4-bit quantized, you know, through a frozen. Let's write through a frozen 4-bit quantized. 4-bit quantized, which is very, very important. Quantized into LoRA. Now that's the first thing. The second thing is, it's basically uses of a new data type called NF4. You would have seen that NF4. That's what. Now, what do we mean by NF4? That's called 4-bit normal flat. Excuse me, not flat, float. 4-bit normal float. Now, 4-bit normal float basically, you know, optimally handles normally distributed weights. You will have your distributed weights. It basically helps you optimize those. It's a new data type. You have to see NF4. So if you make NF4 true, you have to use bits and bytes and all for, of course, for that as well. Now you have your NF4. Then you also have few other things like paged optimizers, double quantization, you know, to reduce the average memory footprint even further by quantizing the quantization constraint. Now, these are the things that are associated with LoRa and QLoRA. Then you have your hyperparameters like batch size and epochs. Now, I'll explain that. You don't need the tab or this to explain that because these are very common. So now you understand this part. This part is very much self-explanatory, a base model code of, you know, you use any fine-tuning code, take it from Medium, take it from other YouTube videos, anywhere, you will find this code only. You know, very similar, 99% of the code will be same. Only thing that you have to change is your data and the way you tokenize and map those, that's it. And few other times if you are using some other LLMs. Now your data set is this, you have your data set where you are, you know, storing it, data set validations, output directory, QLoRA out, then you have your adapter, which is QLoRA, then the sequence length, you can see it says 8192, pad to sequence true, LoRA, I have already explained this part here, Venda B, which is weights and biases, okay, weights and biases for, you know, machine learning, experimentation, tracking and monitoring. Now, we'll talk about a few things which is important. Let me first come down, okay, this is special tokens, we have covered it. Now, let me just go up and explain that to you. Okay. Now, what is number of epochs, guys? Let's talk about number of epochs. The number of epochs, excuse me. The number of epochs is an hyperparameter in gradient descent. You would have seen the maxima and minima. You would have seen this. That hyperparabolic or parabolic graph, once we see the way, you know, backpropagation works and the model learns, yeah, and when we talk about neural networks, hyperparameters in gradient descent, which controls the number of complete passes through the training dataset. Each epoch involves processing the entire dataset once, and the model's parameters are updated after every epoch. Now, batch size is a hyperparameter in, again, gradient descent that determines the number of training samples processed before it's in batches. It sends in the batches. How many samples are used in each iteration to calculate the error and then adjust the model in your backpropagation steps. We'll talk about stochastic gradient descent. It's an optimization algorithm, as we discussed earlier, to find the best internal parameters for a model, aiming to minimize performance measures like logarithmic loss or a mean squared error, MSE. And you can find it out more on the internet as well about that. Yeah, so now batch gradient descent, stochastic gradient descent, and mini batch gradient descent, there are three different ways commonly used, you know, for training the models effectively. Now, you would have sometimes this question, the difference between the batch versus epoch. So the batch size is the number of samples processed before the model is updated. The number of epochs is the number of complete passes through the training data set. So these are two different. Now let's understand with a quick example. I'll just show it. This is the last maybe that I will show. But let me show that. Okay, over here. Now, assume you have a data set. So you have a data set of 200 samples. Rows, or you know, it can be question answer pair or rows in a CSV, and you choose a batch size of 5. So for example, batch size of 5 and epoch is 1000. This will not we will not do it in a fine-tuning LLM because again the compute power will be too much. 5. Now this means the data set will be divided into how many? The data set will be divided into 40 batches. Right? So data set will be divided into 40 batches. Because you have 200 samples, so it has to be in 40 batches. 40 batches each with 5 samples. How many? Each with 5 samples, right? Now the model weights will be updated after each batch of 5 samples. After each batch of 5 samples, model weights will update. Model weights will get updated. Now, this will also mean that one epoch will involve 40 batches or 40 updates to the model. How many? One epoch will involve 40 batches or 40 updates. This is very important, guys. You should know the fundamentals to fine-tune the best way, right? Now, with 1,000 epochs, the model will be exposed to the entire dataset 1,000 times. So that is total of how many? 40,000 batches. Just imagine how much compute power do you need to do that. So the larger batch size results in higher GPU memory, right? Higher GPU memory. And that's where we'll be using gradient accumulation steps. You see this here, gradient accumulation steps. That's why it is important, right? Gradient, that has been used to overcome this problem. Okay, over there. Now you have learning rates. You can see 0.0002. Learning rate is not that so SGD, stochastic gradient descent, estimates the errors and the way it learns, right? So think of learning rate as a knob that controls the size of steps taken to improve the model. If the learning rate is too small, the model may take a long time to learn or get stuck in a suboptimal solution. It might get a local minima, right? So on the other hand, if the learning rate is too large, the model may learn too quickly and end up with unstable. So you need to find the optimal or the right learning rate, right? So it is important as well. Now the learning rate, what else do we have? So gradient accumulation is very important. So higher batch sizes results in higher memory consumption. Now that's where we bring gradient accumulation aims to fix this. It's a mechanism to split the batch of samples. So you will have your, for example, you have a global batch. Let me just draw it if I can. Let me show it. You cannot see if here. Global batch. Then you will have your mini batch. So let me call it MB. So you have MB0, then you have MB1, mini batch 1, and you can see it over here. That's called a micro batch size 2, right? It's all associated with it. MB1, then you have MB2, and then you have MB3. Now imagine if you have this, then you have grad 0. Again, this will be the inside only. So you have grad 0, you have grad 1, you have grad 2, gradient 2 basically, and then you have grad 3, and then you have global batch gradient. Very, very interesting, right? Global batch gradients. Now, it splits into several mini batches of samples that will be run sequentially, right? Now, I'm not covering back propagation because I hope that you know what is back propagation. If you don't, I will recommend to watch, some of the videos which are already available on YouTube. There will be n number of videos for that. But yeah, I think that concludes for this part, guys. So what we did in this video, now you'll be able to understand each and everything over here. Now you know what is gradient checkpointing, and these are like warm up state. After how many steps you want it to warm up, after how many epoch you want to evaluate the model on your validation data, whatever, your saves, after how many epochs you want to save the weights and all of those things, right? So these are a bit again, you can go, and there can be other parameters as well, but I wanted to cover as much as possible. Now, what we did in this video, guys, so far, it's a big video, it's a lengthy video, I know, but I will recommend you to watch this video completely, as I said in the beginning as well. We started with the understanding of pre-training, training LLMs. We looked at the three different approaches. Let me summarize it. We looked at the three different approaches, pre-training, fine-tuning, and LoRA and QLoRA. We covered all of this theoretically till high level on here. And then we moved after training compute to RunPod. And on the RunPod, we set up something called XLTOL. An XLTOL is a low code fine tuning tool for you. So when I say low code, you should understand how it works. But it's very, very, very powerful. It's really important to use this kind of tool to help on you on your productivity, and it helps you become more efficient once you are fine tuning it. So we looked at XLTOL to fine tune a large language model on this particular data, which is alpaca data. I also shown you that where you can change your data. You can look at a JSON file and then you can fine tune, right? We fine-tuned it for 2 hours almost, and we got a Gradio application that we saw. You could see that how easy it is to spin up a Gradio that's already there for you. And we tested out with a couple of prompts, and then we are ending with all of the hyperparameters that are important, that are required, you should know it. We explain that. I hope you understood, you got some clarity now, and you will have enough understanding to now fine-tune an LLM. This ends our experiment, guys, in this video. That's all for this video, guys. I hope you now have the enough understanding of how to fine-tune a large language model and how to select the optimal hyperparameters for the fine-tuning task, and you know, how can you use tool like XLTOL, that's the low-code tool for fine-tuning LLMs. This was the agenda of the video as well, to give you enough understanding, and where I wanted to cover the fundamentals of pre-training, fine-tuning, and the novel techniques like LoRA and QLoRA. If you have any thoughts or feedbacks, please let me know in the comment box. You can also reach out to me through my social media channels. Please find those details on the channel about us and the channel banner. That's all for this video. Please like the video, hit the like icon, and if you haven't subscribed to the channel, please do subscribe to the channel. Share the video and channel with your friends and to peer. Thank you so much for watching. See you in the next.